What's up, party people? Welcome to the next edition, the latest edition of The Rebound. I'm Emmett Golden alongside Jordan Klimack. And before we get into the big Kevin Love news, the All-Star Weekend and all that, we got to tell everybody about Audi in Middleburgh Heights.
Yay, yay! The Rebound is sponsored by Audi Middleburgh Heights with a winning combination of sales and service to get you in the right ride and keep you on the road. Explore what's new with Audi at the 2023 Auto Show. I always say this, Emmett. Mm-hmm. Auto Show is the best time of year because that's when you really know that good weather is coming. Spring is coming. It's like almost like the inaugural thing. Like, all right, good weather is around the corner. And then you can let the team at Audi Middleburgh Heights help you do some spring cleaning by replacing the old with a show-stopping new Audi that will be sure to make all your 2023 adventures enjoyable. Become a part of the Audi Middleburgh Heights family. Visit AudiMiddleburghHeights.com.
Well, an era's come to an end as
the beard era?
Clean face Klimack is what I like to
CSK
call
in the right. house. baby face Klimack.
Yeah. No, Kevin Love is no longer with the Cavaliers. That means everybody from the championship team is gone.
Yeah.
Now, I always hate wording it like this, but I don't know what other way to word it. It just sounds like somebody died when you say it. But what will you remember most about Kevin Love's time with the Cavaliers?
I'm always going to remember, obviously, you know, the 2016 finals. That comes to mind. The stop, you know, what he was able to do against Steph Curry. Though I still always blame Steph Curry. It's like, I understand that you're a three-point shooter, but get to the basket. You had a mismatch. You could have got to the basket. He settled for a jump shot. Though we'll always give Love credit for that. You know, and then he had that crazy historic first quarter. I know that you've mentioned this on The Next Level a handful of times. By the way, great afternoon show, 3 to 5. Check it out. But that explosion in the first quarter, I think he had like 36 points in the first quarter. It was breaking records. It was one of the craziest things I've ever seen. Just going to remember Kevin Love as someone that really embraced Cleveland, made this city his own, and it was off to a shaky start. Like, it wasn't always a perfect relationship between Kevin Love and the city of Cleveland, and I honestly think that's what made it work, right? Like, it was just, I don't know how to explain it, but I think the city started to embrace him, fall in love with him, and he'll always be a part of Cleveland no matter what. Almost 10 years in the Cavs uniform.
He's more of a Cavalier than he was a Timberwolf.
Yeah, isn't that crazy to think about?
You think about that because, you know, when he came here, he was a guy from the Timberwolves, but he's a Cavalier. Now, there's a lot to remember about Kevin Love for me. I remember being excited that the Cavaliers made the trade to get him here.
Remember how it was just kind of like an inevitable thing?
Yeah,
like
soon
LeBron
came
back.
Here, it was like, Andrew Wiggins, see you later.
Yeah, it's like Kevin Love is going to be on the Cavs. Then it came to fruition, and kind of the rest is history.
And then he went from, oh, we're all happy that we got Kevin Love, we got a big three, this should be a championship team, to him becoming the scapegoat and the fall guy for whatever was going wrong with the Cavaliers. It was always Kevin Love's fault.
Remember the tweet from LeBron?
Yeah,
like, stop trying to
out and fit in or something like that.
By
the
way, are we always 100% sure he was talking about Kevin Love? Like, knowing everything that's gone on with Kyrie Irving in, like, recent years –
that's a good point.
You know what I mean?
Because I was around that team, and I could tell you Kyrie was not fitting.
He was always kind of the distant one, no?
Him, Quinn Cook, and Jordan McRae. Like, that's who he hung out with. Those were his boys, you know, and obviously there were other groups of players. But it was I'm just assuming. I don't know who he was talking about. But I do know Kevin was always the fall guy for whatever. Then LeBron leaves, and they signed Kevin Love to a contract extension, a big one. And you're like, why are
huge
they
contract
doing that?
Extension.
Yeah. And not because he couldn't play. It was just like, I thought we were tearing it down, you know, and going to start over. Like, why are you giving him this contract? Then they announced that they're remodeling.
Yeah, I was just going to say. Yeah. Then they were like, we got to get some people in the arena seats this season. So, that's how that happened.
And then from there, he went to like a disgruntled part of the team.
Like almost acting out on purpose to like sabotage his way out. Yeah.
Yeah, just acted during games. Like just throwing
I'll never forget
the ball
that Raptors, man. That was one of the craziest things I've ever seen in a basketball game.
Yeah, yeah. And that was crazy. And also remember Colin Sexton came down, Kevin Love had a mismatch, and Sexton didn't throw the ball into the paint. Love comes out, Sexton throws the ball to him. He guns it at Jed's feet.
Just like,
yeah.
Whipping the ball, man.
And then he went to that. But then he came back and all of a sudden was a great teammate last year and a great leader. And so his story is an epic one.
It's a roller coaster ride, yeah. A lot of ups and downs.
And I'll remember all of it. What I do believe, though, Jordan, is that Cavaliers didn't need him anymore. You know, he wasn't playing well. And I think they looked at it and said, you know what, we'll do him a solid by letting him go because we're not going to play him. I just didn't need him anymore.
Yeah, it's an interesting thing, too, because, you know, I've been on this for a couple months now. Throughout the season of the Rebound, really, I've been talking about Kevin Love and how much he struggled and not understanding why he was still in the rotation when he was in the rotation. And then he gets taken out of the rotation for Dean Wade, which I agreed with. But just the situation of ending up with the Heat, for some reason, I'm like, because I'm out on Kevin Love. Like, I just don't think it was there for him offensively. Hasn't really ever been there for him defensively. He was always a great rebounder. But like, I don't know, like going to the Heat, like to me, that seems like he could resurrect his career there. That's kind of the place where veterans can go and like have like another shot at glory. Mm-hmm. And the Cavs might be playing the Heat in the first round. So there could be a scenario where Kevin Love all of a sudden catches fire, wins a playoff game for the Heat against the Cavs. It's just a weird situation now because I was in favor of the move. Don't think he belonged in the rotation. But I hate to see him go to the Heat and potentially have to play him in the playoffs.
Yeah, it doesn't bother me because just as plausible as it is what you just presented, that he could come back to haunt the Cavs, he could also do nothing in the playoffs, too.
That's almost more plausible, but still.
Yeah, right. So
the demons of Cleveland sports past, man. That's really what it is.
Yeah, and look, I don't think Kevin Love – you know, buying out Kevin Love is going to stop the Cavaliers from achieving whatever their apex is. And I don't think any of us were saying they were going to win a title this year. So even if they do lose in the first round on a Kevin Love 3 or something, it would be ironic, of course.
I just hope it doesn't happen.
But ultimately, he probably ends up on the West Coast with LeBron and Kyrie next year.
Hope that doesn't happen as well, speaking of things.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't believe in – I don't care who the Lakers get. I don't believe in them. No.
Yeah, yeah.
I just
at
don't.
At this point.
Yeah, I just don't. AD, you never know when he's going to be healthy or going to be able to play. So it is – so it's going to be weird not having anyone from the championship team on the squad
sad.
Anymore.
This is like sad for a couple of reasons, too. It's like it's been 7 years.
Yeah.
Isn't that crazy to think about?
Yeah.
It's almost been a decade since the Cavs won that title. And, like, I remember that like it was yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that seems like it was only a couple years ago. We're getting close to a decade reunion for that 2016 championship team.
Yeah. Yeah, it shows you how fast time goes by. Because, I mean, I have a picture. My PlayStation profile picture is me and my two sons at the parade.
Is that glasses, Emmett, days?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And they were, before I got LASIK, they were little. And now one is going to be 20 in like 4 months, and the other one is lifting more than I could ever imagine. But they were these two little kids at that time, and it just shows you how fast time goes. So it's definitely something we'll be talking about a lot here on The Rebound, keeping an eye on Kevin Love and see what he's doing. Over the weekend, they had All-Star Weekend, All-Star Saturday night.
They did.
We'll start by talking about the Future Stars game. It was all right. It was okay.
It's just, here's my thing with that. Is like, why can't we just do like World versus USA or so? Didn't
the
they done
games
that?
Yeah, different, like,
it's because that's what I was so confused by. I didn't understand the format going in, and I tuned in for a little bit, and I was like, wait. So that wasn't just like they still have to play another game after winning that game.
And
it was
then
like
there was another
team
game
Pau Gasol versus like team Jason Terry and all this. What are we doing, bro? What are we doing?
Yeah, they made that too complicated. You know, I wish it was, like you said, either rookies versus sophomores or America versus world.
By the way,
or
rookies versus sophomores. I think that was it. That used to be the game, rookie versus sophomore game. And then they had to try and do this and do that. And I don't know.
And it's still the rookie-sophomore game. They just mix the teams up.
Right.
You know, so it's not like you still have to be a rookie or a sophomore. It's the same amount of guys. They need to go. I'm with you on that. Yeah. They need to go back to that. All-Star Saturday night. Skills competition was whatever. It was kind of filler. I think it's always been that. I don't have a strong opinion.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's like glued to their TV watching
that. And I don't hate it. I'm not ready to run people out of the arena for doing that. 3-point shootout was good as it always is.
It's what you expected, right? Yeah. It's always the same thing.
I hit up, put a little bit on Dame
little
Lillard.
Little Dame Dollar.
Dame Lillard to win the 3-point shootout. That obviously hit. But, Jordan, the best thing that happened all weekend, All-Star weekend, was Mac McClung in the dunk contest.
Is it back now? I don't think we can officially. I don't think we can say that.
So it's difficult to say that. I'm with you. The way I put it is what we witnessed on Saturday night, it was a historic dunk contest, even though it wasn't.
Well, I think it was historic because of what Mac McClung was. The creativity he was able to bring to that. But outside of him, I thought it was pretty lackluster, right?
Yeah.
So, like, I don't think we can say it was, like, a great dunk contest. We can say it was a great performance in the dunk contest.
It's the moment. Yeah. That's what I'm, like, VC. And I put Mac up there with VC, his performance, with the battle that LaVine and Aaron Gordon had.
Yeah.
And what Spud Webb did back in the day in the dunk contest, Jordan and Dominique, even though, you know, there wasn't a true competition because he easily was the best dunker there over the weekend. It still was an exciting moment. He didn't miss one dunk.
That's the most important part, man.
And if it wasn't for Lisa Leslie, which I love you to death, but I don't know what the hell you were thinking on that second 49. Like, I don't know.
Like, what do you have to do to get a 10 on that? I don't understand.
Yeah, it was amazing. And
like, oh, he didn't, backflip in midair, like, four times.
She kept going almost, like, stop it. But I loved it because that's why I love the dunk contest. It's not because all the guys are good dunkers. It's because there's at least one guy, sometimes we're blessed if there's two, that put on a show.
Yeah.
And that leave you going, oh, my God, that has Lance when he was a little kid going, he put a sticker on it. He put a sticker on it talking about Dwight Howard, like that type of stuff. That was that moment, and I was a huge fan.
I agree with you. I thought it was first of all that was a 720 dunker. Yeah. That was insane to see that happen. I will say though, the one dunk was it Jericho Simons that had the where he like pulled out a note. I was like, that dunk was so bad that if Mac McClung wasn't as great as he was, that had potential to just completely ruin the dunk contest.
That would've went
viral. And maybe All-Star Weekend as a whole. That's how bad that was.
That would've went viral.
If it wasn't
for McClung. Yeah, I saw like one meme, but I saw a lot more videos of McClung and everybody just going like, oh my God, what an amazing performance or whatever. But you're right. That was bad.
That's bad.
You know it's bad when like the commentators and the people are like, yeah, that's corny.
Well, who's
that's super corny.
I mean, whose idea was it? Like, dude, just go up there, put your arm in the rim, and then pull out a note. Like, it'll be sick, I'm telling you.
That says 50.
Yeah.
Oh, and by the way, make it really hard to open.
Yeah.
You know, so you open it, it rips in half, and you got to put it together like one of those TikTok things.
Thank God for Mac McClung because, woo!
Yeah.
We've been talking about back-to-back years of just subparness in these contests.
And then the All-Star game, I saw the second half. I was doing some stuff with my son, and you know, before that, and it was an All-Star game.
I gotta say, man, I just like for some reason I just was not entertained watching the All-Star game at all. It got to a point where it was just like I watched two straight minutes of someone shot a half court shot, and then it was rebounded, and then that person got it and shot a half court shot. It was going back. I was like, I could go to the rec center and watch people do this. Yeah. Like, I don't know, man.
I agree. The only thing that saved it for me is I had some cash on Donovan Mitchell.
So,
to just go 25
I did,
or more.
But I was actually mad because I didn't put enough on it. I just had one of those free $5. I was like, I'll just put this on that.
Right.
And I was like, that was the most obvious. Because Giannis, right when that happened, the first play of the game, he dunks it, and then he comes out. And then I was like, oh, okay, that's how this is going to be. LeBron didn't come back for the second half.
Yeah.
Like, the writing was on the wall for this to happen, and it did.
So I agree, though, and that's what the All-Star – this is the thing. Back in the day, and not even that far ago, even last year and years before, when it got close to the end, guys start playing for real.
Yeah.
This year they didn't.
No, not at all.
This year they just were like, yeah, whatever. Let's keep you know, shooting threes from half court.
And the other thing is, like, I feel like for some reason, like, they're just guys, like, Nikola Jokic obviously is one of the best players in the league, mm-hmm. but he's just not, like, an all-star game guy.
His game is,
like, everyone's doing crazy dunks and pulling up from half court, and he's just like, I'm just trying to throw, like, a couple bounce passes.
He's
barely
jumping, getting rebounds and stuff, just kind of like, yeah, maybe I don't belong
exactly.
out here. Right.
Like, Pascal Siakam, too, like, great player, but I was just like, you know, I don't
right,
know.
Yeah. right. Right. So it was All-Star weekend, but there were at least some memories and some good ones there. So that puts kind of a close on the unofficial first half, because there's really only like 20.
The three-fourths of the way, yeah.
What are your expectations for the Cavaliers going forward as they, you know, make this race to finish somewhere in the top four?
Yeah, I mean, hopefully – you know, the 76ers game before the All-Star break was a little disheartening because I really want the Cavs to get that third spot and what that means in terms of playoff matchups and seeding. But they really need a top four spot. And their schedule, you know, coming out of the break is very interesting. I mean, they have some games against the Celtics and the Heat. They play the 76ers again, the Nets a couple times. Like, there's going to be opportunities to make up ground or, you know, further your lead if you do have a lead in one of those spots, Emmett. But I fully expect the Cavs to gun for a top four spot and probably get one because we all know how good they are at home. It's super important for this team to get a top four seed in the East. And if they do that and play their best basketball down the stretch, who knows what the ceiling is for this team, because I do think they have enough talent on this team to be capable of a run in the playoffs.
Yeah, I definitely see him finishing top four. I could see him getting up to three. I know the 76ers are still above.
It's
going to
be the interesting one. How hard do they play down the stretch versus the Cavs?
Right. And also, injuries are always going to be a problem with the 76ers. So, can they stay healthy?
And by the way, same for the Cavs, because that's what cost the Cavs down the stretch last year was injuries. Stay healthy.
Yeah. That and not playing Jetty Osmond. yeah. You know, those two things combined kind of hurt some stuff. So I agree with you. I'm expecting them to continue to grind. There's going to be good days and bad days. You know, they're not a perfect team. They're still going to have us yelling at our TV at times.
Oh, yeah.
And they're going to have us standing up cheering, you know, in our living room.
Well, not me when it's a defensive 3 seconds.
Right.
But still salty about that,
still
by the way,
mad
Cavs.
About that, which is funny. All right. And that no top three. No top three, because the Cavs have been off for a week basically with the All-Star game and stuff. So we'll get back to that next week, and so we'll catch you on the Rebound.
Let them know.